Game On is brought to you by
Winning has never been this simple. Bet with 1xBet.
Game On. It's Game On. We are big on sports. Big on sports.
The lines are open. You can now, of course, make the call and comment about the game tonight. Who do you think will be coming out on top? Will it be Oilers to wrap up the series and win it for the seventh time in a row? Or will it be Canons who will be forcing Game 6 in regards to what will be happening tonight between Oilers and Canons in the NBL playoff finals? That, of course, the line is open. You can make the dial. Now, quickly, let's talk about the Uganda Premier League, because four fixtures were played out yesterday across the country. We'll be starting off with the game between AC Villa and Busoga United. One Chigundu Moses gifted Busoga United with all 3 points, a result that puts Kaziba and company in a very difficult, ugly situation. And you've got to feel for Villa. I mean, the first round was quite very handsome for them, you know, almost finishing in the top two, and then suddenly the 4-1 thrashing away to KCCA, and then suddenly the one in Luera against URA. Now we're talking about them losing 3 times in a row, yesterday against Busoga, an own goal to be precise. These are worrying times for the Jogos.
I think they are, because the two losses before the one, you know, yesterday, the one, you know, that is on the road at the start times against KCCA before the end of the first round, mm-hmm. and then the loss down in Bombo at the Arena of Visions against URA. You know, you are a team that have been climbing up in the recent past, so that was a bit understandable. But for me, yesterday, playing in front of their home fans in Nambole, you could have expected the team to perform a little bit better. And ultimately, it comes back to the hunger from the players. You know, Edward Kaziba had them fired up in the first round, but I think it's a whole different ball game. Mm-hmm. To keep this team energized all across the entire season, and it's going to be the big challenge for him. How does he get this team to overcome what essentially looks like has been a dry patch? Because they are going to need a response. I think for me, if you look at teams like URA, they are slowly but steadily climbing up the table. Mm-hmm. And if they are going to stay within the top four, then they need to pick up better performances. And again, hopefully when Bashir Mutanda gets back into the setting, because he's already such a key player for them. He's been out with injury, and him in this team adds a lot of firepower up front. And he joins guys like Ambrose Kiria. He joins guys like Daniel Owor in there. So if the coach has got options up front, then I think for me that could be the kicker for them. But going forward, you know, they'll be hoping that they can build on some of the achievements they had in the first round, because like you mentioned, Villa was one of the most outstanding teams from the first round, mm-hmm. and hopefully they get better going forward.
Sometimes it goes your way, sometimes it doesn't. It looks like for Kaziba right now, it's not going his way, and we know for a fact that we do have very aggressive AC Villa fans. We've seen them come out at Waso Bossa. We've seen them come out at Shafiq Bissasso, Deo Sorada, all these other managers, Basena recently as well. And they don't take in such results quite lightly, especially at home. And for me, you've got to worry for Kaziba. Yes, he came in the first round, did what he did. It looks like the fans might forget about that real quick. And then going into the second round, all two games going at bay.
I know, I think we were having a joke yesterday in office that Villa is lucky they won so many games in the first round, mm-hmm. that they're at least so far away from the relegation places that they can afford to lose a few games, and when you win one or two and still stay up in the league. But I mean, Villa, for even them, I think they even shocked themselves that all the confusion they had in the off season, mm-hmm. they were able to win as many games as they did. Mm-hmm. But these things can only stay for so long. I think you need to deal with the real issues, and I hope they did deal with them, because either you said you think temporarily or something, or for the long haul, and he's been able to get the results. But their problems, I don't know if they've totally gone away. And once such things start happening, when you start losing, mm-hmm. that's when people start referring to those things. But you'd feel that I feel like it's a small bump from what they showed in the first round. Mm-hmm. They have the ability in them to put up a good run of results, mm-hmm. and they will finally get them. I thought they would have won against Busoga United, but they didn't. But nonetheless, that doesn't take away the fact that they will be able to pick themselves up and get good results.
Well, Fahad Bayo came out to haunt his former club side, just like he did in the reverse fixture. A breast one from a penalty, along with Mwemezi, who also scored a breast for Vipers, who are now 7 points clear. In a way, for Proline remaining rock bottom, in a way for Vipers staying top. And that kind of creates a very huge gap between Vipers and Proline. It does realistically. But for Proline, rather, for Vipers, 7 points clear, capitalizing on the faltering for KCCFC. Down in Kavumba, you've got to now start thinking that these could actually be champions in waiting.
I think you know, for Vipers, it's pretty much a title in their hands right now, because clearly 7 points clear, that is quite the size of body they've got on KCCA, and it doesn't get any better than them having the opportunity now, because KCCA have got a couple of issues here and there. So I'd want to think that if Edward Gola can organize this team and get them running, then they could be quite the fierce team. But that being said, the big downside about the win last evening is that they lost a couple of key players to injury. The midfielder Siraji Sentamu went off injured.
Oh, yeah.
You could speak of the team captain Khalid Wadiwa as well, who picked up that challenge. Obviously, came back to play, but even then, he couldn't play on that much longer, and he had to be taken off. So, how they cope with these injuries? Because I noticed the youngster Okoa coming off the bench to pretty much, replace Khalid Wadiwa. So, can they be able to, get the best out of the squad? The thing that I liked about the game yesterday was that now that they've got Paul Mucherzi, he gives them a whole different dynamic, especially going forward. And it looks like he's quickly been able to fit into the forward line, and he's gelling with, Fahd Bayo is quite impressive as a team. So there's options going up front. They went down quite early in this particular game. A lot of character coming through from them to score back-to-back goals from Mwemezi and certainly Fahd Bayo as well. Obviously, Bayo, after scoring his goals, he didn't celebrate because he was coming up against his former side. But I think for me, Vipers are in such a beautiful place to be able to push for another title.
Dennis, for Proline, it's kind of a story that takes us back to the year before they got relegated. And right now, Matthews Anthony, that is Bouguere, the head coach of Proline, comes out and time and again emphasizes how they won't be going down that easy. In a way, we know for a fact that in the UPL, if you don't win games like this or even get points off games like such against big sides, it's going to be very difficult for you to survive the axe. And last year, we saw them succeed quite well under Bisasso, winning a double for the very first time in their history. And that looks like the opposite this season.
I think why Proline finds itself in this position because of that game they failed to play against Sevilla. That's where the problems began for them. I think instead of concentrating on the football, they started to focus on things that were really not important, and in the end they may come back to haunt them. But Proline has the quality in that team to survive in this league if they had only started well. But that game against Villa in the first round took a whole 6 points out of them. If you add those 6 points what they have right now, and at that time Villa was actually struggling. It was very easy. If that game had taken place, you'd bet your money on Proline picking up the match points, or even playing at home. But since they didn't, then they've been able to struggle. Coach Shafiq went away, Matiale came around for some time and also went away, and they're also involved in the CAF competitions. And some of those things are very hard for teams that don't have a very big squad. So they find themselves in a difficult place. But still, from what I've seen from the highlights, Proline has been haunted this season a lot by their goalkeeping. It has not been up to standard, and I feel they should be having a better quality shot stopper in there. Ever since the departure of Saidi Kenny to Villa, Saidi Kenny was quality enough. But Matovu and Bashir Sekaja, who was there before he went back to Vipers, have not done themselves any justice. I remember even the game against KCC, one of the goals was the fault of the goalkeeper. So they will need to improve in that department. And I know they have a very good goalkeeping coach, Ibrahim Magisha. He should be able to help them improve. Some of the goals against Vipers could have been kept out, but once they went in. But still, for me, what I wanted to mention, Vipers is doing things KCCA used to do when they won the titles. Signing a player like Muchuruzi, it shows intent and a statement that you're trying to get the best players to help you win the league. In this window, KCCA is there to sign any player, and the Vipers went in there and get themselves a very good player. So I feel that, they are, like you mentioned, they are champions in waiting, and unless the only blip they may have, I think, will be the Chan tournament. They may use quite a number of players and very key players. Remember that time when Fahad Bayo was missing when they were with the Cranes team? They had some faults because they couldn't find goals from the other players. So maybe at that time is when other teams could take advantage, like KCCA or anyone else who's chasing them. But 7 points means Vipers has to lose at least two games and draw one, which is very unlikely right now.
Well, tell you what, of course, we do have Paul Mutwaezi who came out on his debut scoring that goal against Chetume. If he continues this way, he might just buy himself a ticket into the Chan 2020 squad. That being said, for Julius Mariamungu, he broke the deadlock down in Arua right before a one Patrick Baiga, leveling it for Maroons FC, who previously had lost to Proline. And of course, a point being shared between Ndu Paraka and Maroons FC down at the Green Light Stadium. Of course, the other bigger game that did happen was the Kavumba Recreation Center, where the reigning champions in KCFC were literally standby bright stars of Paul Chiwanuka 2-1. It finished down in Kavumba. We earlier on hinted on how the fans were very unhappy with that result, Brian. And in a way, it takes us back to, without the fans, you don't have a club to run, because then the fans do make up the club itself. But for KCFC right now, we could talk about the downfall last year when they failed to qualify for the CAF Confederation. Even then, before they were demoted to the CAF Confe group stages. But for Mike Mutebe right now, he looks not really bothered, especially yesterday when fans came out of him saying all kinds of words, remarks, after losing against Bright Stars.
I remember that win against Bright Stars, against Barra City rather, you know, last week. And he showed a lot of confidence, you know, after they had picked up that win. And you could clearly see that he's a man that stays really calm, even when results are not entirely going his way. And I think for me, at the end of the day, KCC are going to need to get their house in order sooner rather than later, because losing against teams like Bright Stars is completely unacceptable for them as a team, because they've come and set the bar quite high for themselves. Obviously, you could say that the players that are currently available should be doing better. And for me, I really think Kerisa Setsambu should be stepping up a little bit better. Unfortunately, the squad has been reduced because players like Sadata Naku couldn't get their issues in terms of licenses to be processed before the kickoff of the second round. So you feel like if they had that guys like Anaku firing in the team, that would have probably given them a little bit more confidence. The Nigerian Odumwengu, we've not seen that much coming out of his side. I think for me, by the end of the season, they'll be looking to offload him and ship him out of the side. So clearly, for KCC, they look like a team that might need a bit of freshening up. The coach, in his own words, believes that he's only going to empower the youngsters that he's got at the team, because he says they've earned it, they've shown a lot of potential, they've got the capacity to be able to keep the team going. But you wonder if they have the legs and they have the mentality to be able to, you know, last it out, especially when it comes to pushing for critical things like the title. So again, these are the questions that have been raised time and again when it comes to KCC. Unfortunately, I really feel like the team have got to pretty much get things, you know, better quick, because if they do not do that, then every single point they drop could see them getting in a position where they are now double figures behind Vipers, and you don't want to see that early in the second round.
More four fixtures will be happening later on this afternoon in the Uganda Premier League. Match day 17, we do have the Ankole Lions welcoming the Wakiso Giants, the Purple Sharks, and for the Tax Collectors away to Bull FC, Chetume welcoming Toro United, and for Mukwano Gwabanji in Express FC will be away to the Cops in Police FC. We'll be starting off with the Ankole Lions, of course, recently losing out to KCC FC. They'll be entertaining a side who also lost their previous outing in Police FC. Two sides, Dennis, who are desperate to get back to winning ways. A 1-0 loss for Branson Nyondo against the reigning champions, and a 2-1 defeat for the Purple Sharks, who also need to come out and prove themselves. They can actually, you know, compete for top four, and then top five.
I think the highlight in this fixture is Livingstone Babazi facing his former side, Mara City. I think he did wonders with them last year before he moved on to Ndu Paraka and then Wakiso Giants. But Wakiso Giants they showed intent. They are an ambitious club, and they will need to. I think they started off with the wrong foot, losing to Police last weekend, and Livingstone Babas is yet to get the monkey off his back. But I feel this is a fixture they can be able to pick up a good point. Not a very hard game. We know how Livingstone and Babazi teams play. They like to express themselves, and he has the quality in that Wakiso Giants side to be able to pick up the win. I saw Mbarara City playing against my own KCC the other week, and there isn't too much there that should be able to worry Wakiso Giants. I know Wakiso Giants has better players than Mbarara City, Mbarara City, and I think for me in this one I would tip Wakiso Giants to be able to get the win.
Brian, in Jinja, we do have Bull FC recently being stunned by Bright Stars in Kavumba. They're up against a URA side who look much better than they were in the first round.
Yeah, URA have looked extremely rejuvenated. They look like a whole different side so far in the second round, and I think it's pretty much the same thing that we saw with them last season, because if you remember, Before they went on to finish third last season, they had a very slow start to the first round, but somehow they picked one in the second round, and they went on to see their place in the top three. So you can clearly see that they look like a team that always get going when it comes into the second round, which is the run-in. The players are in there. I think Sam Simba has got the quality. You could speak of guys like, Saidi Chayune. You could speak of folks like, Shafiq Kajimo in there, Ashraf Mandera. So there's no doubt that they've got the quality. And I think for me it's going to be a very interesting game, arguably the best game that we should be seeing today. Because for Bo, for Peter Onen, the challenge is going to be how does he harness playing at home and get the best out of the squad and get them to pick up the win, especially after they lost a game against Bright Stars that everyone thought that they should have been able to pick up a win in. So it's going to be quite the challenge for Bo. But I really fancy them to come out with a positive outing and ultimately, who knows, probably collect all the 3 points.
Dennis, Miamia's charges in Chetume, 5 defeats in a row. Of course, for Miamia, the first one against, the first game in charge coming out against Vipers. They're up against a troubled Toro United side who recently acquired the services of Mohamed, should be Chiseka.
Chiseka,
yes.
Yeah. The slaughterers, like they are called, Chetume, they're having, I think, a tough time in the league trying to find their feet. They used to have a fortress when they were playing down in, I think, somewhere in Mukono. And since they decided to move their home games to Nambole, things have not gone so well for them. I think Jackson Maja is only here to salvage anything, and they would want to stay in the top. Mm-hmm. The key thing in this picture, I think, will be if Toro United will show up. They were able to raise at least 7 players in their last game against Onduparaka, and who knows if they will be able to show up this weekend. There have been issues. They've had a lot of administrative issues, and they have affected their competition ever since Wasabosa left, and I think most importantly, ever since Smart Obed relinquished ownership of the club, things have not gone as they should have. They should be. So right now they are struggling to raise players. First of all, you don't know if all their players they have been properly licensed. Clubs like SCA, who seem to have structures, are also struggling with the same. You wonder what's happening at Toro United.
Mm-hmm.
So in all, Chetume will be looking to pick up the points. I feel this is a relegation 6-pointer as well, because both teams are down there in the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
And if Chetume is able to pick up the win, the league is so tight that after Bright Stars picked up those two wins,
they're
already out of the relegation zone. And teams like Express already look like they are so close to the bottom. So any win right now against the teams that are in the bottom gives you a lot of mileage towards moving the top. So I feel like Chetume are miles ahead in this fixture.
Brian, can Police FC build up on that 2-1 surprising win against Wakiso Giants? They're up against a very familiar opponent, Mkwano Gwabanjo, who had a very rough first round. Obviously for them, right now it's about surviving and picking off where you left. But for Police FC, can they feed off that victory of Wakiso Giants?
First of all, they'll need to adjust to move into a new home, which is the Star Times in Lugogo. They've been there before, but I know it's going to be a big challenge for Abdallah Mwiro and his boys. They've got quite the interesting quality of players, and I think for me, players like Beno Chen can really continue to step up like they did in the first round. They've got a very interesting option in there. But you look at this Express team, and you are thinking, had a very strong start to the campaign. For the first 6 or 7 games, they were pretty much steamrolling opponents, and then along the way, they started to struggle. And you wonder what happened to the front three, Disan Galiwango, Frank Senyondo, and Frank Kalanda in there. So I think they'll need to rediscover that spark. And it's going to be upon the head coach, George Semogre, to make sure that he gets the boys kicking in the second round. I think Police know what it feels like to play on the AstroTurf, so it's going to be something that will give them a bit of an edge today. And I really think that if they can come out and play with intent right from get-go, then they are a team that could fancy their chances today.
Briefly looking at the UPL table as it stands for Vipers, they are 7 points clear at the top of the pile ahead of the reigning champions in Kampala Capital City Authority Football Club side of coach Mike Mutebi, having succumbed to their fourth defeat of the season and their first for the year 2020. Bull FC right there in third place. That could change if actually they get that one change for them, because they are way behind KCCFC. Onduparaka level on points with ACM Villa, who also did succumb to defeat yesterday. Actually, they dropped two places. That is in for the sixth in time league champ. For Busoga United, after that surprising victory away to AC Villa in Nambole, they find themselves at 24 points, 3 behind the Jogos. For the tax collectors, they have a chance to actually move up to 5th place if they do get the result today. That is away to Bull FC. And the other half of the table has Maroons, Mbarara City, and Express FC in 9th, 10th, and 11th place, respectively. Fine margins, if I should say, just a point separating the three club sides in Maroons, Mbarara, and Express FC. For Brightstars, after those two huge wins against the side in Bull and against the side in KCCFC, that season climbed into 12th position, level on points with Chetume, who have a chance of getting back to winning ways, winless in their last five. And I tell you what, it is worrying times for Chetume. If they keep up this way, they might head back where they came from in the red zone. But it's Toro and Proline who are, of course, bound to get relegated if they don't get the right results. That being said, let's talk about the wildfires that happened in Australia. The qualifiers of the Aussie Open already underway. We had a few victims who came out complaining of chest pains, which was labeled as coughing feet. I tell you what, more delays in the Aussie Open qualifiers down in Melbourne ahead of the big game. The big game starting January 20th. That should be on Monday. It's still bad air, and the organizers are still doing everything they can to actually have the air sorted.
Yeah, earlier this week we saw a Slovenian, that is Dalila Djakovic, actually pulling out of her match. And she came out and said that it was about the quality of the air, which was quite poor. Certainly we've seen so many of the matches in the qualifiers having to be halted. And I think it's quite the unfortunate events that have happened in Australia across some of the major cities, because what happens is it's affected millions of hectares of land. We've seen about 28 people losing their lives. So many animals have also died as well. And it leaves so many question marks on whether or not they'll actually be able to pull off a successful Australian Open. Mm-hmm. And they've come out and said, as the organizers, that they are, focusing a lot of energy on assessing information that comes in real time to make sure that it's a safe environment and atmosphere for everyone, right from the fans to the players, to the supporters that get come through, to the officials and everyone that is involved in the tennis ecosystem. So I think at the end of the day, the hope is that the tournament goes on and it goes on as a success, because last year we had some really interesting tennis, especially for guys like Rafael Nadal, Novak Djokovic, and Naomi Osaka as well. So going forward, let's wait and see. But I think for me, there's so many question marks on the tournament happening altogether.
Well, for Giovanni Lesolso of Tottenham and Eric Lamela, the Argentine-inspired Tottenham Hotspurs of Jose Mourinho, are into a fourth place round two at St. Mary's, where they'll be facing Southampton 2-1 against the Championship club side in Middlesbrough of Jonathan Woodgate. Quite the result, Dennis, yesterday. What they needed after two big defeats against the Saints and against Liverpool in the EPL.
I don't know how long Spurs fans will be patient with Mourinho and his style of football. Mm-hmm. I think under Pochettino they were used to being explosive. Even when Spurs lost, they would lose 4-3, 5-2. But Mourinho is still playing for results, in my opinion, and he's not been able to play that expansive football that Spurs fans were used to for the last 3 years with Pochettino. Mm-hmm. But last night they were lucky against Boro threw everything at them. But in true Mourinho style, they were able to survive and pick up the win and move on to the next round. But, that still tells the whole story. I don't know. We know Jose will try and prioritize something, either top four in the Premier League or, going on to win a cup tournament. So whichever it is, I don't know what he will go for. Mm-hmm. But I feel that in the end, this is just a fourth round of the FA Cup. Mm-hmm. You want to play those many games when they're also still in the Champions League. So they'll have to choose something. But Boro had two former Spurs players on the touchline in Hurricane and
Woodgate.
Unfortunately, they were not able to frustrate them at the London Stadium. But I do not see Spurs going any further than this. And they're struggling for goals without Hurricane. I think that's what they're trying to get in the guy from Portugal. But nonetheless, it won't solve their goal scoring problems.
Well, Abraham, we've seen it's taken two decades for Tottenham to lift something major. The last time they came close to that, that was last season when they played Liverpool in the Champions League. They're eight-time FA Cup winners. But that being said, one player in Christian Eriksen looks like he said his goodbyes yesterday. He might be heading out to Italy to join Inter Milan.
There's been reports that Inter Milan actually would give him about £100,000. That is after taxes, which I think for me would be a handsome pay for him. And Eriksen already was 27. Really feel like, unfortunately, the events that have led up to his exit have not been the best, because we all know on his good days, Agüero, one of the most creative midfielders that the Premier League has seen. And it's not the best of sights when you have him leaving the team under such circumstances. I really felt like Mourinho could have gotten a little bit better out of him. But I think that will leave a big void for Tottenham to fill. Whichever player they choose to bring in to play in that particular role has got to be able to deliver for them, because Eriksen has played at the very top level, especially under Mauricio Pochettino during his peak days. But hopefully he gets to rediscover himself, because the players that have gone to Inter Milan, Romelu Lukaku, and some of the other guys in Italy, including... Chris Smalling. I think it's only Alexis Sanchez that is here to pick up. So hopefully he gets back to his top.
Elsewhere in the FA Cup third round replays, we had the Magpies in Newcastle putting a four past Rochdale. Their record signing in Joelinton finally scored, ending his 20-match goal drought. As far as the Newcastle fans were concerned, their owner Mike Ashley, for the first time, came out to watch the Magpies play some football. And they'll be up against a Coventry City side who managed to put up three past Bristol Rovers. Max Abiyamau scoring a breast. As for Tranmere Rovers and Watford, that game was not played. Why? Because the turf at Tranmere Rovers was waterlogged. And for Shrewsbury Town, they managed to go past Bristol City late on. A goal came through from the defender in Aaron Pierre on 89 minutes from 25 years out. Tonight, more FA Cup football lineup. United will be away to Wolverhampton Wanderers. As for Carlisle United, they'll be facing the side in Cardiff City, which promises to be another interesting affair for the lower division clubs. As many thanks to you, Brian. Many thanks to Dennis Musali for coming through, for giving us that insightful information in regards to the bilateral series. Tomorrow, the women will be returning with their final sporting stories. Up until Friday, with myself and Brian, we'll be returning on your screens. Till then, have a good day.
Game on. It's game on. We are big on sports. Big on sports.
Game on is brought to you by
Winning has never been this simple. Bet with 1xBet.